HarperCollins presents The New Girl by Ingrid Alexandra, read by Sarah Kants. Prologue. 20th of August, 2016, 4:17 a.m. The smell of blood lingers. It's on my clothes, though they've been washed clean. On my skin, though I've scrubbed it raw. Light is shining through a crack in the door. The yolk-orange glow steals across the bedroom like an intruder, illuminating the white, pinstriped shirt that hangs from the clothes horse. The empty sleeves dangle, twitching now and then in the breeze from the window. I tune my ears to the sounds in the next room. He's pacing, thinking. "Mary," he mutters. "Mary, Mary." As I curl against the cold wall, my skin tingles with adrenaline. He always said I couldn't be trusted. Now he's right. In the closet, under a pile of dirty laundry, there's an overnight bag. It's an old one of my mother's, with white daisies embroidered on dark green canvas. A toothbrush, some makeup, and a few items of clothing are all it contains. They've been waiting there, waiting for the right moment. Footsteps sound in the hall and stop outside the door. I hold my breath. The tide is rising, and I can hear the waves as they swell and crash on the nearby shore. The door opens, and he stands, silhouetted by the hall light. "Mary, Mary, quite contrary," he slurs, the hint of a sneer in his voice. "What are we gonna do with you?" Chapter 1. 3 months later. I heave over the basin. There's nothing left to come up. I spit, turn on the tap and splash my face. It's bad this time, worse than usual. But I know it won't stop me. I'll only do it again. Gulping a mouthful of stale water from the mug on the sink, I take a deep breath and tiptoe out of the bathroom. Sunlight streams through the floor-to-ceiling windows that lead to the balcony, making me squint. The sky glares sapphire blue. The overzealous shrieks of children and families drift up from the shore below. People out and about, doing whatever it is regular people do on a Sunday afternoon. Kat is in the open-plan kitchen by the counter, bent forward and shaking out her shower-wet hair. Her fingers comb the long, raven-black strands, and fat beads of water drip onto the kitchen floor. "I'm still freaking out about that accident," she says through her hair. "You could have been killed." I watch her upside-down face, forcing down my irritation. I could slip in the puddle she's making and crack my skull on the tiles. Then I might really be killed. "It's nothing, just a dent." "It's not the car I'm worried about." Kat tilts her head, one perfectly shaped eyebrow arched. I wonder if she knows I lied about how much I'd had before getting behind the wheel. I sip the coffee she's made me, but it tastes too bitter. "The car barely hit me. Nothing a little buffing can't get rid of." "Which I'll sort out," Ben interjects, winking at me over his shoulder as he nudges past Kat to get to the kitchen sink. He pours himself a glass of water and swallows it back in three large gulps, once the hangover wears off. "Ugh, I guarantee mine's worse than yours," Kat moans, flipping herself back upright and pushing her wet hair over her shoulder as she leans against the kitchen counter. She looks fine to me. I'm positive I'm the most hungover. "Whose idea was it to crack open the vodka?" Ben and I exchange a look. But before I can be found guilty, Kat's phone rings and she jumps, knocking over the empty cocktail pitcher. It clatters loudly into the sink and my head pounds in response. "Shit, I'll get that in a sec. This could be about the room." Retrieving the pitcher, I make a half-hearted attempt at clearing some of the housewarming collateral while Kat takes the call. Ben steps over a squashed lime wedge and right into the puddle on the floor. He slips and yelps, arms shooting out, hands finding my shoulders and clamping on. His fingers dig into my flesh. I gasp, my chest contracting. Ben's laughing, his feet skidding on the floor. Suddenly the ground slips out from under me and my spine connects with something hard. Spots of light dance before my eyes. "What are you two doing?" Kat shakes her head, one hand on her hip, the other holding her phone in the air. "You both look retarded." She looks at me and her brow furrows. "Mary?" I shake my head, ducking to hide the tears. When I look up, Ben's there, his face close. His irises are a strange colour. Not quite brown, not quite green. "I'm sorry, did I hurt you?" he asks. I can't answer. My throat is too tight. "Sorry," Ben says again, "but his kindness is too much." I turn away. Ben lets me go, clears his throat. "You know," he says, addressing Kat, "it's actually your fault we're in this situation." He points to the tiles, which are now more grubby and smeared than wet. Kat ignores him. "Good news! I think we might have a candidate for our new roomie." "Seriously?" I say. The last few applicants have been less than desirable, particularly the creepy middle-aged guy who wouldn't stop staring at Kat's cleavage. "Yep, she's our age, I think, doing some kind of arts degree at uni. She works part-time and she's available right away." "Another girl?" Ben moans, then pauses. "Did she sound hot?" Kat narrows her eyes. "You have a girlfriend? And I only spoke to her on the phone. How the hell should I know if she's hot?" Ben shakes his head sagely. "You can tell. And Gia isn't my girlfriend. She's just a friend." "Does she know that?" Rolling her eyes, Kat turns to me. "What do you think? Are you okay to meet her later?" "Sure," I say with a shrug. But anxiety whispers across my chest at the thought of meeting someone new. I try to ignore it. "Great," Kat squeals. "I'll just text her to see when she's available, okay?" "No worries." I step out of the kitchen and take a moment to breathe. Eagle-eyed Kat pauses in her texting and slings an arm around my shoulder. "You okay there?" I manage a smile, though I'm still edgy. "It's better here, isn't it?" Kat gestures to the high-security intercom system with its intricate array of buttons. "I'm glad we're here. I feel safer, don't you?" She smiles in that goofy, affectionate way that only an old friend can, and wraps me in her arms. As I inhale the smell of coconut shampoo and childhood, the waves of the past whoosh and roar in my ears. Chapter 2. 22nd of November, 2016. Dear Journal. I guess that's how you're supposed to start a journal entry, isn't it? I've never written a journal before. Or I might have, as a kid at school or something, but I can't remember that far back. I suppose I should introduce myself. I'm Mary. Hello. It's a while since I've written anything, actually. I used to write a lot. I found it cathartic. Anyway, here I am, making a start. I might not be doing everything Dr. Sarah advised in our last session, but at least I'm doing this. Mark used to say I never followed through with anything. Slacker, he'd call me, as though he was one to talk. Dr. Sarah said keeping a journal will help to record my thoughts and feelings so I can catalogue my moods and compartmentalise my issues, or whatever it is she calls it. She wants me to keep track of any changes. It helps to put things in words sometimes. It makes things seem smaller when you can fit them into a little box. At least, that's what Dr. Sarah tells me. There's a quote I've got stuck in my head. I can't remember where I heard it, but it goes, "The only constant is change." a profound truth summed up in a paradox. It's pretty fitting to my current situation. Nothing is permanent, so you'd better not get too attached to anything, right? I mean, why waste your energy? But we do. It's human nature. People, possessions, ideas. We latch on like mollusks, suctioning for what we crave, whatever we think is going to get us through. The good news? Whatever terrible situation you may find yourself in, it will pass. The bad news? The things you depend on, really depend on, pass too. Often when you least expect it. Often before you realise you're dependent to begin with. But I digress. So, changes. Where to begin? The biggest one. I've left. I got tingles just writing that, though not good tingles, yet. I'm hoping that will come in time. Yes, there was that initial euphoria, freedom. The world had opened up, and suddenly I was able to be a part of it. I wasn't hiding anymore. But then something happened, I don't know what. It shrank back, I guess, into a claustrophobic bubble I can't escape. It's as if reality is elastic sometimes. It can expand and contract, or change shape depending solely on how you view it. My old fears have crept back in, as though they'd been waiting until there was room for them, and now there is. They say the world gets smaller the more you see of it. Perhaps that's what's happened to me. I'm exploring more of the world now, so it's more accessible, less immense. I say that now as if I'm the confident, brave person I'm supposed to be, but the truth is, I struggle to leave the house most days. The world in here feels so much safer, like I have reign over it, while the world out there reigns over me. It's funny. The heebie-jeebies, Dr. Sarah uses some of the lamest terms, kick in at the strangest times. Right now, for example, I can smell his cologne, as though he's just been in the apartment, which I know is impossible. It's probably a waft of the cheap deodorant Ben douses himself with after a shower, but I still get a jolt. Sometimes I'll see him in the faces of people walking past, or in the shadows of my room at night. Adrenaline prickles over my skin like an army of ants, and I have to get out, have to walk, skip, do something, or I'll go mad. The fear can be paralyzing. Sometimes I don't have the drive to do any of the above. Sometimes all I can bring myself to do is drink. That's proving the hardest habit to break, like saying goodbye to a faithful friend right when you need them most. I'm lucky. That's what they all keep telling me. Really? Am I? It seems like a pretty ill-fitting word for someone like me. I prefer Dr. Sarah's way of putting it. She says, I'm brave, whether she means it or not. But lucky? That implies a lack of choice or control, as though I had no say in what happened to me or how it turned out. When I left Melbourne, my best friend was willing to pack up her life and move out here with me in a nanosecond. But I'm not lucky to have her. We both put energy into cultivating and sustaining this friendship. It wasn't luck that drove me to leave, although it played a role in those final moments. And it wasn't luck that got us this apartment. It was Kat's tenacity and charm, and the fact that she wouldn't take no for an answer. She wanted me to be somewhere where I could forget the past, she said. Like a change of location has the power to do that. But it's a nice thought anyway. It is pretty amazing, this place. Not so much the apartment itself. The rooms are small and there's a disproportionate number of bathrooms to bedrooms, 1 to 4. But it's brand new. Still smells of paint. It's high up on the fifth floor with a spacious communal dining kitchen area, and it has a massive balcony out the front overlooking the water.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.